My name is Ignacio Ramirez.
I'll be your moderator for this morning's session. And welcome to Archetype Pattern Workshop. This is a school, and it is not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any church or religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to proving the existence of Yahweh or Elohim and the operation of his eternal pattern, purpose, and plan operating throughout eternity unto this present day. Now, this school is the result of a divine panoramic vision and revelation given to Henry Clifford Kinley in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. And we have established schools throughout the United States, Canada, and certain other foreign countries. Archetype Pattern Workshop was established of February 2021. Now, in this school, or these schools, we use and teach by the true and original names and titles for the Heavenly Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It's been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It's also been improperly substituted by God. And the true name for the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God, they are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lords many and Gods many. We now know that each Lord must have a name, and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for himself. Now, Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in the alphabet that would produce a sound made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the death of the Messiah. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, He is incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized in this pure spirit state on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because the cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. And this shape and form can only be seen in a divine vision and understood in a divine revelation. Later on, the self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, who the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title could be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he called Moses on top of Mount Sinai and showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. And he instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. And we go forth to the school to prove that everything in the universe moves and operates according to the structure and function of the threefold tabernacle pattern, and absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Now the 10 aims of the school are as follows. One is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and as he actually exists. Two is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, modern, practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. And seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith that was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning ordained, there is no other name given among men whereby man must be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah, with the hope of immortal glorification in the newer state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan, speak the truth. This morning we have a prayer by Dr. Samuel Salas. Our scripture lesson is Ephesians, the second chapter. Our scripture reader will be Dr. Eunice Reiser, and we have a selection of music after the prayer.
Good morning, class.
Just hold it in your hand close to your mouth.
Okay. Oh, it's a time of prayer. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for keep this place open, the place of the highest learning, and also thank you for give us peace, love, and joy in this world. This world is in chaos, but we are saved. Thank you for keep us in that state. And keep feeding us with us all this knowledge. We're learning so much in so little short time, because our life is like a dove, is passing through in this life. It's too short. Nevertheless, we try to learn the most we can for our salvation, because whatever we need, we learn here, we need from another dimension. I say all those things in your only son's name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Woke this morning and in a full fright, I dreamed that Yahweh took it out last night. I wasn't standing where I should have been. He said, you know you knew better. You knew it was the end. Saw my brethren all dressed in white. They didn't know me as I stood there and cried. I knew the tears would run down forever. There was no sound of glory for me, just the sound of his displeasure. But when I did awake, I was so relieved to see the sun smiling through my window like his son smiling at me. Oh, when I did awake, I was so relieved to see there was still some chance for me. Brother, what a nightmare. Really had to be there, yeah. Brother, what a nightmare, yeah. It was awful, y'all, cause I wasn't saved. Got to the wire and I had to misbehave. I couldn't run and I couldn't hide in the presence of his anger. I was a pitiful sight. I woke this morning in an awful sweat. I took a moment out to catch my breath. Cause when you dream about that lake of fire, you just wanna know more and more to be all he desires. Yes, when I did awake, I was so relieved to see the sun smiling through my window like his son smiling at me. Oh, when I did awake, I was so relieved to see there was still some chance for me. Brother, what a nightmare. You really had to be there. When I did awake, I was so relieved to see the sun smiling through my window like his son smiling at me. Oh, when I did awake, I was so relieved to see there was still some chance for me. Brother, what a nightmare. You really had to be there, yeah. Brother, what a nightmare, yeah.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
Our scripture lesson will be taken from Ephesians, the second chapter, and I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts revised by the late A.B. Trainum. Ephesians, the second chapter, page 257. And you has he quickened who was dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, and the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our deportment in time past in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But Yahweh, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, has quickened us together with the Messiah. By grace ye are saved, and has raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Yahshua the Messiah, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us through Yahshua the Messiah. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of Yahweh. not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Yahshua the Messiah unto good works, which Yahweh has before ordained that we should walk in them. Wherefore remember that ye being in time past heathens in the flesh, who called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hands, that at that time ye were without the Messiah, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenant of promise, having no hope and without Elohim in the world. But now, in Yahshua the Messiah, ye who formerly were far off are made nigh by the blood of the Messiah. For he is our peace, who hath made both one and has broken down the middle wall of partition between us, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself of twain one new man, so making peace, and that he might reconcile both unto Yahweh in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby, and came and preached peace to you which were afar off, and to them that were nigh. For through him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father. Now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the sons and of the household of Yahweh, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Yahshua the Messiah himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto a holy temple unto Elohim, in whom ye also are built together for a habitation of Elohim through the Spirit. I have read Ephesians, the second chapter. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Okay, thank you. Good morning once again. I'm going to ask Dr. Ari Ramirez to come up and lay a foundation, basic foundation of the tabernacle and the greater, more perfect sanctuary, and to correlate the seven steps between them. That's all. Okay. And
good day, class. So I'm going to lay down a little bit of the foundation. Okay, and start with the tabernacle itself. The first one is the gate. Second is the altar of sin sacrifice. Third is the water laver. And fourth is a door with the holy oil for the high priest and the two low priests when they're officiating up in the most holy place and the holy place. They had to be anointed. And so they officiate in there. That would be four is a door. The fifth step is the whole holy place with the candlestick, golden candlestick, altar of sin sacrifice, altar of incense. And the table of showbread, the 12 loaves of bread that would go with the 12 tribes of Israel. This is the most holy place. I mean, the holy place right here. The fifth step. Sixth step is the veil, the second veil that leads to the most holy place. Most holy place has Ark of the Covenant, had two archangels that face each other and witness unto Yahweh once a year, when he would forgive the Israelites for their sins. And in this Ark of the Covenant had a table of showbread, the Ten Commandments, and Aaron's rod that budded, and
table of stone.
Yeah. Well, I said the Ten Commandments, that's the table of stones. That's in here. Now, the second one right here is the trek of the Israelites when they were leaving Egypt. Now, the first step is the door that, did I say the seventh step right here? Did I say seventh step? Because it's the seventh step. Okay, now we're talking about the Israelites that are leaving out of Egypt. The first step is the door to their homes. The second step is the, I'm losing it again. You guys can help me.
Took the blood, the door of the Israelites' house.
Yes.
She said that.
The door. Okay, but the second step is the blood on the door, right?
The slaying of the lamb.
Slaying of the lamb. And on the door is the, that they had to put from a basin, the blood of the lamb. And they had to put it from the top of the doorpost to the side post of the door from the basins. Okay, and the third step is when they had to go through the Red Sea.
That's right.
You know, they followed that cloud, was like the fourth step to go into the holy place. But they followed that cloud that lit them by day, and by night, they were never in darkness. So that cloud was by day. It was light to them. And in the evening, there was light. So they followed that card, the cloud. So one, the door. The second, the blood. The third is the Red Sea. And the fourth is to follow the cloud. It's like the, like what we see up here, too. Uh-huh. Well, the only no, no. Okay. And then now when they go into the holy place, this is the
wilderness.
The wilderness, I'm sorry. Wilderness of Sinai. This is the, this is the fifth step, is the holy place. And the holy place, what did they have there? They had light, like I was saying, because they had that light to lighten darkness when it was dark. That was a cloud. And then they had the food, the way they had food, because they cried to Moses, and he asked Yahweh, and he rained down manna, so they were fed. So that was the, what do you call that bread?
Shewbread. Showbread.
Showbread. Showbread and manna. The manna, okay? And also, that was the food, the bread. And then the one that, the intercession in the holy place was through, they spoke to Moses, and Moses will speak to to Joshua, the son of Nun. So he was the minister unto them. So they had the light, the bread, and the intercessor was, like I said, the son of Nun. That was the fifth place. Now the sixth points to the Jordan River. That was the veil, the sixth step. Seventh step is Canaan land itself. But then also they had, just as we had the Ark of the Covenant, we're learning about this, they had made a more better and more brighter place with Solomon's Temple. That's what we call it. And it was put on like a temple. And this temple, they had a porch, sanctuary, and oracle. Now, these are all gold up here. And they had these, also they had the stuff that was in the holy place. They had it in the temple, but in the temple it was magnified in there. And also on the oracle, it said that the people would stand and knew that this was the house of Yahweh, the one that brought them out of Israel, I mean out of Egypt, into Canaan's land. And it was shining so bright that when the sun hit it, I remember I was told, and I did read somewhere, that it shines so bright that you couldn't look upon it because it could blind you. But that was the house of Yahweh right here in the most holy place. So that's the seventh right here. Okay, also I want to say that when the children of Israel, when they were getting ready to do the Passover, they were told to do this. People are wondering, where'd you get this from? People, if they don't read the Bible, they're not going to learn about this Moses. Moses had told them that they had to take out a lamb. because that lamb was going to guide them through. They had to be full of it within themselves. They had to eat it all and no legs would be broken, because it was going to point to, we learn afterwards, that it points to Yahshua Messiah. Just like now, we have to learn all that we can about him so we go on through. And that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that. I was reading a couple of days ago one of Dr. Kinley's transcripts, the ever presence of Yahweh in the conduct of IDMR, okay? And about halfway, a little more than halfway, Dr. Kinley was talking about the tabernacle and about how the unity of Yahweh, okay? Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua. And let me show real fast, and I'll get down. I imagine looking at this chart here, because that's what he was explaining, okay? Yahweh, the most holy place, Elohim, holy place, Yahshua, Messiah, okay? And he goes over to this chart. The way he was talking, he goes, Yahweh, Elohim, Yahshua. And he said, well, people will say, well, what about the court round about? And he says, no. And the class answered, does anybody know what these stand for?
The boards.
No. The class answer, staves. Yeah, you can read it there. It's in there. You know, that blew me away, staves. Then he explained how the tribes, you know, 24 elders around here and how they moved. But these pointed to staves, okay? And I didn't know that, you know, but he was using the charts. So that was something I thought I'd share with you. But we'll call the next speaker, Dr. Will Williams, okay?
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
It is indeed an honor and a pleasure to be here with you to learn more of this great and awesome, colossal, stupendous, panoramic vision of revelation given to us by Yahweh, our Elohim, who is the resurrected Yahshua the Messiah. And I appreciate the previous speakers, what they laid out as a foundation, because it is the foundation of what we believe in, which is the archetype pattern of the universe. Okay, we're still on our winter series of lectures, but I had no particular lecture I was going to go into. That's not to say I don't have anything to say, because all I have to do is turn around and look at these charts, because the charts will say it for me. But if there's any questions or suggestion of a topic, you know, I thought about even continuing from last Tuesday's workshop, you know, about the history of things, you know, and other things that maybe we should be more familiar with, but we don't tend to get into them as much for whatever reasons, you know, like for example, just the aforementioned of the staves, you know, a lot of people wouldn't know about that, you know, the staves that that carried the Ark of the Covenant was also in the temple. And see, and they had to be in the Ark of the Covenant because, you know, they couldn't touch it, but they had to swivel the Ark around. See, you know, the staves coming out like this, they would have to get in between and turn the Ark around, all the way around. And when they turned it around, then they could flick eastward. And then after they flicked the blood seven times eastward, then they would turn it back around and then, you know, come back out on the other side, a figure eight, actually. What I want to do today. Moses. Let me talk about that. Since we've been talking about Moses and the migratory trek. Where can I start? How about Romans 1, 19 and 20? Let's start there. I have an idea for a subject, and I need to kind of lay out at least a little bit of a groundwork, and I want to start with this.
Romans. Romans 1, 19 and 20. Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifested in them. Mm-hmm. For Yahweh has showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, mm-hmm. being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and supernal nature, so that they are without excuse.
Okay. So, am I on?
Yeah.
Oh. Okay. All right. As the scripture says, it takes the natural to understand the spiritual. And a lot of things we cannot see because they are spiritual or invisible. But so we take the natural things to understand that which is spiritual. Okay. Even his eternal power and supernal nature, so that they are without excuse. Now, his supernal nature, that's the Godhead. The Father, the Word, the Holy Spirit, and these three are one. His eternal power is the power of transmutation, okay? Because that's how the ages come into play. That's how they come into being, actually. And that's how they go out. It's by the process of transmutation. Spirit, pure spirit here, transmutes in part into the shape and form, which is known as Elohim, which is the great heavenly anthropomorphic being, also known as the Word or Son. Then this Word or Son took on a physical body. See? And it's still Yahweh Elohim and Yahshua. It says Yahweh Elohim Yahshua here. It says Yahweh Elohim Yahshua here. And it says Yahweh Elohim Yahshua here. Even in the abstract thing. So wait a minute, I don't see no shape and form yet. No, in principle, he's there. Because Yahweh is the all in all. See, Dr. Kinley put it like this. Because people have an idea to think that, well, Yahweh became Elohim, or Yahweh became the sun, moon, and stars, or became the plants, became the man. That is not what happened. Yahweh did not become that for the simple reason that he already was that, even in an abstract state.
Mm-hmm.
The only thing he did was just simply made it manifest. See, it wasn't like something he had to come up with, anything you could think of, or whatever, How did Dr. Kinley put it? The human mind cannot conceive what it cannot perceive. Since you cannot perceive this pure spirit state of being, then you cannot conceive anything about it. Thus it behooved Yahweh, by process of transmutation, these attributes taken on shape and form, in part, not in totality. See, as an expression of himself, and that could be seen in a vision and revelation. And then to wipe out your excuse, he merely came into the flesh. So you have two manifestations of the one spirit. Okay? This is the original 92nd Adam. Now, I wanted to go to something else, but Yahweh's pushing me in this direction. This is the original hydrogen atom, okay? And see, and there's the controversy about Dr. Kinley. It's not a controversy to me, but it's a controversy to some other people about whether or not he received a PhD, or not, from Fisk University, an honorary degree, that is. And see, according to the story, Dr. Kinley received it based on his dissertation, an oral dissertation in front of the faculty about the hydrogen atom. as compared to the prevailing doctrine at the time, what he called science of mind. Okay? Now, science of mind, now just the concept of mind. See, mind itself is changeable. It's going to change either one or two directions, either for better or for worse. Okay? Now, the universe is not built on that. It's built on the law of the spirit, which is he himself, talking about Elohim. He himself is the law of the spirit that permeates through every cosmographical phase of the creation, both physical as well as angelic. Okay? Here, we have the angelic creation. We have the physical creation, all right? And we use this analogy, and so we got this dotted line here, and we always use this analogy about plants and animals, okay? You know, we tell you this, you know, we got the sun shining here, all right, and we got the trees, and then we got the man, all right? The sun shines on the plants. The plants absorb the sunlight in a process called photosynthesis, which they use to make their food, which is called chlorophyll. Now, another ingredient the plant needs is this, CO2, which we know as carbon dioxide. They need that, all right? So they absorb the carbon dioxide, but guess what? They really don't need the whole compound. The only part they really need is the carbon part of this compound. They'll take it along with the photosynthesis. They'll convert it into chlorophyll, which is food for the plant. Now, the O2 part, the oxygen, they don't need. It's a waste product as far as the plant is concerned. See, but guess what? We'll take it, and so will the animals. We'll take that O2. And exhale carbon dioxide. So there's a symbiotic relationship between the plant kingdom and the animal kingdom, including the man, right? This is a natural example to look at to understand the relationship between the angelic creation and the physical creation. It's the same symbiotic relationship, okay? Now, going back to the 92nd atom. Now, the reason why Dr. Kinley classified the hydrogen atom as the 92nd atom, you ask any chemist, he'll tell you. And we have one back there. We have a periodic table of elements here, big size, you know. And they'll tell you, well, there's 92 natural elements, okay? And anything beyond the 92nd element, which is uranium on the periodic table, is a man-made element. Because they've looked at 91 different examples of how everything is threefold, how there's an atom, and that atom is a proton, a neutron, and an electron. Okay? Three different parts, but it makes up one atom. So they've had the example to look at, okay, to say, okay, well, you know, if we add this, that, we could create some more elements past 92. Okay? But the first element, see, the first element is hydrogen. And hydrogen, basically, hydrogen basically has one proton and one electron. That's basically, and see, somebody said, oh, wait a minute. You mean to tell me it's only twofold, it's not threefold? Because I keep hearing you guys talk about all the time how an atom is a proton, neutron, electron, but then the hydrogen atom is only a proton and electron. So something's missing. It ain't threefold. So we got an anomaly here. That's what people would think, that this is an anomaly. Okay? However, to show you the principle, see, we started off with taking the natural to understand the spirit. Hydrogen, you ask any of the scientists, will tell you, is the most abundant element in the universe. In fact, when I took an astronomy class many years ago, and they told me this, they said that if you was to break it down, hydrogen would be like 90%. And then you have helium, that's the chemical symbol for helium, that would be 9%. And then everything else, would be 1%. But now, check it out. That lets you know right there that 99% of the universe is a gas or a cloud. See, that shows you that right there. And that the small, minute part, like, for example, here in this particular galaxy that we call the Milky Way, on the outer rim, see, there happens to be a set of planets in a solar system, 9 planets to be exact, in a solar system, which corresponds to the 9 vessels in this tabernacle pattern, which corresponds to the 9 systems of the human body, of which the human body is patterned after this pattern. Okay? So, in other words, you have a man, and I got to find it. It's in storage somewhere. But I taped this years ago. These astronomers, it was a man and a woman. These astronomers, they mapped the universe, and they mapped it, and they used the Earth as a basis, and when they put the map together, and they put all these different slides together of photographs that they took, it came out to be the image of a man standing over the Earth. It's mind-blowing. I got it on tape. It's on one of my old VHS tapes. If I can find it, I will upload it to YouTube or to my Facebook page or any, you know, it takes about 15 minutes to watch and to watch what these people did. And when they showed that, I first time I saw it, it blew my mind because they used the Earth as a base. And then they had all the pictures they took from all different parts of the sky, and they put these slides together. And when they put it together, it came out to the shape and there was a shape and form of a man standing there over the Earth. And I was like, wow. I said, now how can you deny that, see? But anyway, hydrogen is the father of all the elements, okay? And here's the thing about hydrogen. Hydrogen has isotopes. Now, an isotope is a variation of an element. First, let me put this up here. Because when you look at atoms, see, atoms is a really fairly modern thing because, you know, people for many hundreds of years didn't even believe in the concept of it. They had other concepts on what they thought the elements were. And it wasn't until the early part of the 19th century when I think it was a chemist, British chemist named John Dalton. He was the one that revived the ideal of the atom. See, the atom, was started by this guy. Democritus. This was like 2,500 years ago. All right, and he was the one that came up with the word atom. Well, the word atom is Greek. Comes from the word atoma, all right, or atomos, all right. And it means indivisible. It means it gets, in other words, you can't divide it. And see, this guy, his idea was simply this. And this was like 2,500 years ago. He just simply said, well, if you took an object and saying you divided it in half, all right, and then take another object, then take that half, divide it in half, take that half, divide it in half, so forth and so on, keep dividing the halves until you get to a point where you can't divide it anymore, or atoma, or indivisible. And that's what the concept was. And now at the time when he came up with it, this was like 2,500 years ago, they laughed at him. I'm talking about the people like Aristotle and Plato. They all laughed at him. They said, oh, this is ridiculous. All right? But then come to find out that he was really right. Matter is made up of subatomic particles. Okay? Now, in the hydrogen atom, see, you have this, let's see, you have the proton and you have the neutron, which are relatively about the same size. The only difference is the proton is a positive charge and a neutron has no charge, but a neutron has weight and it has mass, whereas an electron is like this, you know, very small compared to these two behemoths. However, it makes up for its lack of size with a strong negative charge. Okay? Now, going back up here to hydrogen. As we said, hydrogen has the ability to break itself down into what we call isotopes or variations of an element. All right? One such isotope is this one. It's called deuterium. All right? No, it almost sounds like Deuteronomy, right? See, the word deuter means second. See, so this is a secondary version of hydrogen. And what it has one proton and one neutron. Now, that right there should tell you that's a difference. Because, see, we got a scale here. The neutron is bigger than the electron. So this deuterium, because it has one proton, one neutron, this is heavier than this. Okay? Yes. In fact, we know water is H2O. It's a compound, probably the most common compound on this planet. However, deuterium, it can do the same thing with oxygen. You can have D2O, which is called heavy water. This is what they use in atomic reactors, all right, with cadmium rods to control the flow of radiation, see, all right, so because this is heavier than this, all right, okay. Now, this can go even a bit further. It can go down into a third isotope. This is called tritium. All right, and tritium has one proton and two neutrons. All right? In other words, so this is heavier than this. Okay? However, with just look at the word tritium. Tri means three. So that just tells you right there, so there's three particles here, one proton, two neutrons. Okay? Now, tritium has the ability to glow in the dark. In other words, it's radioactive. It can emit light. It can glow in the dark. In fact, back in the 40s, 50s, they used to coat radio, watches that were luminous, those old luminous watches. I used to have one. And they would put a little bit of tritium in there to make it glow until they found out that it was radioactive. You know, see. All right. But these are two manifestations of the one element. Why? Because it's pointing to the two manifestations of the one spirit. Hydrogen, deuterium, tritium. Two manifestations of the one spirit. Hydrogen. What is the characteristics of hydrogen? Well, it's odorless, colorless, tasteless. You put a flame to it, it's highly explosive. Why? Because see, this is Yahweh Elohim. See, this is pure spirit. You can't see him, can't perceive him, can't, you know, nothing. But he's a consuming fire. Get it? Okay? Right? And so you got deuterium here. Deuterium, they use deuterium, you know, to make waters. And so when he spoke, talking about according to John, it was like the sound of many waters. See? And then here we got tritium here. Because tritium glows in the dark. That would be like Yahshua and Messiah, because he said himself, I am the light of the world. Okay? So from the natural standpoint, see, you see the elements pointing to the supernal nature or to the unity of the Spirit. You got two manifestations of the one Spirit. Okay? And this is the reason why Dr. Kinley received a PhD. Now, according to some people, it's bogus, but not to me, because this is really a very, if you ever read comparative exegetical analysis, it's a very powerful treatise. And it's the one, in fact, other people helped to write the textbook, but someone even offered to write this for Dr. Kinley. Dr. Kinley waved him off and said, no, that's okay. This is my baby. It's my baby right here. I'm going to explain this. Okay? And he did. All right? Now, in saying that, I may as well just go on and do the whole hog here. Let me get plate. I want you to stay at the camera unless someone else is going to get up. Yeah. Okay, thank you. Well, I didn't mean for you, but but if you want to, go ahead. Number three, play three and four. Two, three, and four. That's what I want. That's one. Okay. Two. All right. We'll put them right here. Three. And four. All right. Thank you much, sir. All right, and four. All right. Here we go. Here, theosophy. All right, now, you see here these nine attributes here encased in the tenth attribute, which is the kingdom. A lot of people think because the word kingdom here is in the court roundabout, they think that somehow the kingdom is in the court roundabout. And it's not. It's just written there because that's where the space to put it, but it's showing you that these nine attributes are immersed in the kingdom, okay? Just like you have nine systems here in your physical body. They are immersed in the tenth system, which is your skin, okay? Now, this heart that we just showed you is the same heart here. This heart is Elohim. They're both one and the same. All right, so here we have up here Moses, and he's told to come up. It's the second trip, and he's told to lay his body down, and he receives a panoramic vision of Elohim. All right, and he sees this, the shape and form here, standing on the paved work of a sapphire stone, transform into this tabernacle pattern, then back into himself and into all the days of the creation, every aspect, every cosmographical aspect of the creation, this heart. Okay, which is Elohim. Now, as I said here, this heart and this shape and form here is Elohim. All right, and here's Elohim here, and he's coming through the veil, coming out from pure spirit, from behind the veil of inscrutability and incomprehensibility. When he comes out, see, these attributes have to take on shape and form. Intelligence is what comes out first. And that represents the crown of the attributes, and it's flanked by wisdom and knowledge. Look how the words, see, they're over his head. It's like a crown, all right? And they form a triad. And this triad gives birth to the next set of triad of attributes, beauty, flanked by love and justice. And these attributes give birth to the next set of attributes, which is foundation, flanked by power and strength. And all nine of these attributes are embellished in the kingdom. Okay? All right. This is, as we stated earlier, this is the great heavenly anthropomorphic being. All right? That just sounds fancy, but it simply means having the shape and form of a man without fleshly counterparts, because this is heavenly. This is incorporeal. Super incorporeal, I might add, okay? Now, here in cosmogony, here we have this heart. See, this heart here, as we said, this is Elohim. Now, if you notice, this heart is red, and then we have this gold part on the outside. The reason why it's depicted like this, because it's trying to show you the heart in the act of beating. Let's see if I can do this. See, that's what this heart is doing. It's beating. And see, and a heart is, from a natural standpoint, it's a pump. And it pumps blood, you know, throughout your body. So now here's Elohim. He's pumping out existence, okay? And so now here he is. He's going to come through this veil. Now this veil here is a division between spirit and matter, all right? And so now he's going to come through this veil. And coming through the veil, he's going to transform in part into one hydrogen atom, okay? Now, this hydrogen atom could be, you know, it was told no different than anything else. Be fruitful and multiply, Okay, and then one became two, and two became four, and so forth and so on, and created the gases of what we call the second heaven here. These are the three heavens. This is the third heaven, which is eternity. This is the second heaven, and the gases that is being formed here makes up for the atmosphere that occupies the second heaven. Now, coming through the veil, this is dividing the first and second heaven. Coming through the veil now, see, is coming down into this, what we call, Dr. Kinley called it, an amalgamated conglomeration of a coring mass. All right, and look, and this picture really don't do justice, because this was just, see, what you're looking at is the creation of the universe, as we, the physical creation as we understand it. Now, the scientists, they can trace this back to the first atom that was born, that was created, but they cannot go beyond where it came from. They say, well, we see it coming into existence, but we don't know where it comes from. The reason why is because it comes from behind a veil. This veil here, which is a division between spirit and matter. So they can't go behind this veil to see what is the origin of that, not without Yahweh's permission. Okay? Now, and that's how this universe, see now, and these, and look, this is the angelic creation here on this veil. And they were created first. The angelic creation was created first, then the physical creation. The physical creation is a mirror image of your creation. I know this is boring because I've gone through this before, but that's okay. Because we just want to show you the repetition of the pattern and show how you're just as much an integral part of it as the universe. Now, this is an ovum, which is an unfertilized egg in a human, okay? Now, this ovum needs a sperm. So we got a sperm coming here, and I just drew one, but actually you got, you know, just multiply this times 60 million, okay? And so you got 60 million sperms here that's coming here, and look, and they're going to dot all around this egg. And the first one that gets to this egg is not necessarily the one that's going to penetrate this egg. In fact, it takes the concerted effort of all 60 million sperm to put pressure on the egg enough so that maybe somewhere it'll crack or open up somewhere to allow a sperm to get in. And then once the sperm gets in, see, once the sperm gets in, then the tail is broken off and the head of the sperm is implanted inside this ovum. And for a short time, even with the implanted seed sperm, it is still considered to be one cell. Then this process will happen. See, I'm getting tongue-tied. It will now become a zygote, because now it's fertilized, okay? And then it will go through a process, which is called mitosis, which is cell division. In other words, this one cell will now become two, two becomes four becomes eight becomes 16, so forth and so on, and then trillions of cells later, here you are. But you started off as one cell. Why? Because your creation mirrors the creation of the universe. It started off with one atom, one hydrogen atom. Even the scientists, just based on their observations, I think I have my science book here. Yeah, I do. Just based on their observations, this is what they say. Ah, here we go. This is what they say. And this is what they call the creation of the cosmos. So now they say here that what they call the Big Bang, all right, and maybe I'll get into that a little bit, what they call the Big Bang theory. And so here's this particle, the first particle that appeared out of nowhere, so to speak. They can't. They don't know where it came from, but they can detect. Now it appears. Then it multiplies, and then it goes through a period of what they call inflation. These particles are created, and then these particles come together, become molecules, and so forth and so on, into elements, and then in turn they become these big galaxies and stuff like that, and you know that goes on. This is just based on their observation, what they can observe in the universe, and this is what they say. And it says, well, and then we're going along because the universe is constantly expanding, but then it'll get to a point where gravity will take over and it will stop the expansion, and it will pull everything back in, and then that will be what they call the big crunch, and it will go back into that singularity of which it started from. In other words, the end declared from the beginning. Now, that's what the scientists say based on their observation. They're not reading the Bible or nothing like that. They're looking at their observation and say, well, you know, it started off as one atom. So the way we can see this, it's got to end off with one atom. Okay? See? And that's no more than what we're saying. It started off with Elohim. Started off with Elohim. And it's got to end with Elohim. Maybe we'll get to that. Now. And they expect another universe. They expect another one. They say, well, you know, because they figure, you know, well, yeah, they expect another universe. In fact, they get into the talk of multiverses, which kind of tickles me. It's almost like saying, are there multi-Elohims, you know, that kind of thing. But really, what they don't understand is that, see, Elohim is the one that walks through the ages, and he's the one that determines the ages and the dispensations. And he's the one that's walking through them. And by him walking through the ages and dispensations, he is setting the times, you know, determined through the Holy Spirit, through these men, these dispensations coming up. Because dispensations can close an age as well as open an age. And it's Elohim that's doing that. Just like we mark time, or we mark a calendar by the movement of the S-U-N, the ages and dispensations are marked by the movement of the S-O-N, the Son of Yahweh. See, going through. And it started off with Elohim at the beginning, and it's going to have to end with Elohim, who was the original 92nd atom. See, that's the thing. Boy, how can I do with this? I'll bring this in. As I said earlier, the atom is a modern-day thing. Like I say, it started off in ancient times, and people forgot about it for 2,500 years. But it was brought back into play in the 19th century, and physicists began to research and look for the elements or the evidence of it in earnest. All right? For example, like the electron was discovered by this guy, J.J. Thompson. I think he was from New Zealand. He discovered the electron. See? That little minute particle that with a negative charge. Yeah, he found that. Then one of his students, his name was Ernst Rutherford. And he discovered, let me get another one. He discovered the proton, and that the atom had a nucleus. And he was a student of this guy. And this was in the late 19th century, in the 1890s. His thing was, it's a very famous experiment, it's called the gold leaf test. You can look it up, Google it, and look it up, the gold leaf test that he did to prove that there were subatomic particles, that there was a proton and a nucleus to the atom. Then years later, this guy, James Chadwick, he discovered the neutron. All right, and I'm going to put a date up here. He discovered it in 1932. He wrote a paper about the neutron. Now, Dr. Kinley received a vision and revelation in the year 1931. And he identified the particle in the vision before James Chadwick wrote about it in his paper. But Dr. Kinley saw it in a vision a year before the paper came out. See, All right? And so that's what I'm trying to show, because, see, the hydrogen atom, it would, because the hydrogen atom doesn't have a neutron. And so it would think, so people would say, well, this is an anomaly. But that's not what the purpose shows. The purpose shows that the proton and the electron of the hydrogen atom is immersed in the invisible third part, which is pure spirit. Let's get Exodus 24, 9 and 10. And Isaiah 66 and 1, but I want Exodus first.
Exodus 24, 9 and 10. Mm-hmm. Then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel. And they saw the Elohim of Israel. And there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of a sapphire stone, mm-hmm. and as it were the body of heaven in its clearness. Mm-hmm. And upon the noble of the children of Israel he laid not his hand. Mm-hmm. Also they saw Elohim and did eat and drink.
Okay, good enough. All right, so now he's standing on the paved work of a sapphire stone. So now let's find out what that is. That should be in Isaiah 66 and 1.
Isaiah 66 and 1. Mm-hmm. The Spirit of Yahweh is upon me, because Yahweh has anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted.
No, that's
Isaiah 66 and 1. Oh,
Yeah.
That's okay, dear.
Okay.
I'm just blind in one eye. I can't see out the other.
Okay, I know maybe my memory was.
Okay, I got you.
Thus saith Yahweh, the heaven is my throne, mm-hmm. and the earth is my footstool.
All right. Heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. In other words, he is the 92nd atom. He is the proton, and he is also the electron. And saying this is the same as this heart, and this heart is in the midst of this cloud. See, here's another way to look at it. Here's the angelic creation. Here's the physical creation. The angelic, in this case with the hydrogen atom, the angelic creation, that would be like the proton. The physical creation would be like the electron. And both of them are embedded in the invisible third part, which is Yahweh, or eternity. See? Okay? See, and this was the thing that Dr. Kinley explained, see, to the people at Fisk University, which he received a degree from, okay? And that was really the thing that is the heart of, it's really the heart of our doctrine, to understand what Elohim, and that's why he said Elohim is the archetype or the original pattern of the universe. See, they used to tell us when I first came to class, Elohim, this is a one-man band because he's doing everything. See, he's both the structure and the function. The structure being this tabernacle pattern, threefold, most holy place, court round about. See, and the function, it's the priesthood here that operates in this tabernacle. Just like in your tabernacle, you have physiology, see, the structure and anatomy, the function, see. And that's the same principles you're going to look at all the way through. See, the Big Bang. Let me explain the Big Bang theory. In 1931, actually, the same year of the vision, this guy, Georges, this is the guy who came up with what people call the Big Bang Theory. And the Big Bang Theory simply is this. This guy postulated, and this guy was a Roman Catholic priest from Belgium, of all things, but he was also a scientist. And what he postulated was, because, see, it had been discovered by who was it? His name was Hoyle. I think it was Edwin Hoyle. I believe that's his name. Edwin Hoyle. The Hoyle telescope is named after him. See, this guy discovered that the universe was expanding, what they call the red shift. And I think I went through this one session. I talked about it, about the Doppler effect, all right? If you remember, the Doppler effect is something that we all experience all the time. You just stand on a street corner. And like next time, you know, you hear a siren, like a police siren or an ambulance, just stand on the street corner and listen to it. If it's coming towards you, it'll get, you know, the pitch will be higher. Then when it passes you by, the pitch will be lower. That's called a Doppler effect. That's with sound. With light, it's the same principle. If an object is coming towards you, then the light of that object will shift toward the higher spectrums, or the ultraviolet, or in other words, it will appear blue. But if an object is moving away from you, then it will affect the light in the opposite direction, what they call the infrared, and it will appear red. Let's just say this. If I took a balloon and filled it with air, and it had dots on it, polka dots on it, just polka dots everywhere, as I fill the balloon up, as the balloon expands, the dots will move apart from each other. Just simply pretend these are galaxies. It's the same thing in principle, and that's what this guy discovered, because when he looked at the light of these galaxies moving away from each other, it shifted toward the infrared part of the spectrum, or a red shift. All right? So that's why they thought that. So this guy came up with this. So this guy, after hearing about what this guy said, he said, well, if the universe is expanding, then there would let's just think about it another way, in reverse. What if it, you know, would just go in reverse, just, you know, roll the movie back, you know, then as expanding, just roll, and then just roll it back. And then he said, well, this would have to start from one particular element, or one primordial atom. This is what he said. It would have to start with just one. And that's what Dr. Kinley drew out. He confirms what Dr. Kinley wrote. And because here, he's got one atom here, the hydrogen atom. Okay? And out of that atom, you have all the other different elements. Okay? Now, it was brought out by the first speaker and second speaker about this tabernacle pattern. Okay, and this tabernacle pattern, see, this is the divine pattern that Moses was told to build in the wilderness of Sinai, and that he was instructed. Well, let's just read it. Let's start with Hebrews 8 and 1. Let's read that first.
Hebrews 8 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
Now, of the things which we have spoken, this is the sum.
Mm-hmm.
We have such a high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens,
mm-hmm.
a minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle, which is pitched.
Which what?
Which Yahweh pitched.
Thank you.
And not man.
Which Yahweh pitched and not man. This is the tabernacle that Yahweh pitched and not man. You can either say this about, I'm looking at the migratory pattern. This is the greater and more perfect sanctuary, you know, that Yahweh pitched and not the man. Okay? Now jump down to the fifth verse.
Who serve unto the example and shadow of heavenly things,
mm-hmm.
as Moses was admonished of Elohim when he was about to make the tabernacle.
Mm-hmm.
Foresee, saith he, that thou make all things according to the pattern showed to thee in the mount.
All right. Make sure that you do it exactly the way I showed it to you. Do not deviate from it. Okay? And listen, the creation is the same way. It's created by the pattern, and it can't deviate from what Yahweh has set up, which is really himself. Okay? I'm trying to think if I need to bring something else into this. Uh, I get it. This is ye old periodic table of elements. Okay, I think that'll work. The periodic table of elements, okay? This was, and look, in fact, look up the word periodic, period. Now, this table of elements was devised by a Russian scientist. The name of this Russian scientist is Dmitry Ivanovich Mendeleev. He was the one who came up with with this periodic table of elements. Do we have the word period, periodic?
You just want the word?
The word periodic. I want a definition.
Okay.
Periodic. It's on the board here. Appearing or occurring at intervals.
Mm-hmm.
Chemistry relating to the periodic table of the elements or the pattern of chemical properties that underlies it.
All right. The pattern of chemical properties that underlies it. And the pattern that I want to get into that underlines it is the archetype pattern of the universe. Okay? All right. That's what I want to do. Now, this was the guy who came up with the periodic table of elements. And he received this in a dream. In a dream. He received this in a dream. And then and was shown to him in a dream. And then he came out and came up with a working set of what he did. And he predicted. He predicted three new elements that people would discover and showed what slot they would be in. And showed what slot they would be in. And they thought. At first, I said, "Well, what is this? This must be some kind of gypsy science or something, you know?" Until they really took the time to investigate what he did, and they saw that it had merit. And so what you see here is the adaptation and the evolution of what Mendeleev first came out, because all the elements that you see here were not discovered at that time. See, as we said here, see, there are 92 elements here. See, with uranium as the 92nd element, all these elements past uranium are what they call, back in my day, they used to call them rare earths. But now they just say, well, these are artificial elements. And it's color-coded, too, so to show that these elements are in families. In other words, they're related to each other. See, they're color-coded because they're related to each other in some way. All right? And really, when you stop and think about it, this is like the races of man you can even look at. Because stop and think for a moment. We're from the earth. I'm talking about man. We're created from the dust of the earth. And the same elements in the earth are the same elements that are in this body. The same elements you see up here, we have the same elements in this body. There's no difference. The only difference is this is organized or organic. Whereas if it's not alive, then it's inorganic, okay? But now look here. We got hydrogen up here, and see, everything else is color-coded except hydrogen. It's white. It's in a category by itself. And I don't know you can see the number up here, right? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I want that number. See, 1.00994. That's the atomic weight. That's the atomic weight for hydrogen. 1.00 what? 794. That's the atomic weight, and it's measured in what they call AMUs, atomic molecular units. Now, a good mathematician can take this number and round it off to the nearest decimal, all right, if they wanted to. The nearest number would be 1.008. That would be this number rounded off to the nearest decimal, 1.008. And this is the atomic, and in some cases, if you ever look it up, you may even run across this number when you look up hydrogen as far as the atomic weight is concerned. Well, guess what? Park Avenue, that happened to be the address of the house where Dr. Kinley was at when he received the vision. So the house that Dr. Kinley received the vision is the same as the atomic weight for hydrogen. Okay? Coincidence, of course. Just thought I'd bring that out. All right, now. Oh, I'll leave it up here. Now, we'll go back here. Now, hydrogen, as I said, this is the father of all the elements. It's in a category of its own. And so now we go down here. See this yellow compartment? These are alkaline metals. And these metals here, these elements here, are very reactive. Lithium is reactive. Sodium, potassium. I know potassium is reactive. You know, you could take a pinch of potassium and drop it in a glass of water, and you'll get a nice, good reaction. You know, they're very reactive. Rubin, cesium, I know that'll burn underwater. They use that for underwater flares. You could burn, see. So these are the most reactive, among the most reactive elements that there are, okay? Now, as we said, we're going to look at the pattern of the tabernacle, see? So now, if you were to take this, let's just take this and we'll put it upside down. Now, you can see a little bit more how this is happening. See, this would be like the altar of sin and sacrifice here because there's a continual burning. I just need a pattern plate. Plate 25. All right. Now, as I said, this would be like the altar of sin and sacrifice here, okay? Because these are reactive. And see, on an altar of sin and sacrifice, there was a continual burning here, okay? Now, I got to turn back up. Now, if you look here, see this part right here? It's showing you that this section is taken out from up here because they didn't have enough room. So they took it out and they profiled it here. This first line, the first element here is this element. It's called lanthanum, okay? And the elements along this row is called the lanthanide series. Now, the word lanthanum, if you check out the etymology of the word lanthanum, it means hidden. See? Why would it mean hidden? Draw a line. See, that would be like the brazen laver here. See, because the brazen laver is where they washed everything. Or they, you know, washed the priests, washed themselves and the animal. And it's a type of a baptism. See, just like down here at the Red Sea, the Israelites were baptized in the cloud and in the sea. Maybe we should read that. 1 Corinthians 10 and 1. See, that's a baptism here, and that's what this element, lanthanum here, that's what this is representing. It means hidden. That's what you look up the etymology of the word. If you can find the etymology of the word, that would be nice. Is it up there? Oh, okay. Lanthanum. I need the etymology. I need what it means of the word itself. Let's see. Lanthanum is first. No, go back. Go back for a minute. It might have said something on there. Yeah. Read the second paragraph.
Lanthium usually occurs together with siricum and the other rare earth elements. Lanthium was first found by the Swedish chemist Carl Gustav Mossender in 1839 as an impurity in
cerium nitrate.
Nitrate. Hence the name lanthium, from the ancient Greek lanthium, meaning to lie hidden.
All right. That's good enough. You see, it means to lie hidden. See, to lie hidden, see, or buried. See, that's a type of a burial. See, do we have the scripture?
Okay. First Corinthians 10 and 1. Moreover, brethren, I would not that you should be ignorant how that all our fathers was under the cloud, mm-hmm. and all passed through the sea, mm-hmm. and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea, mm-hmm. and did all eat the same spiritual food, and did all drink the same spiritual drink, mm-hmm. for they drank of that spiritual rock that went with them, and that rock was the Messiah.
Okay. See, so now we're seeing here, because we're looking at this periodic table, and I'm trying to show that it's going by the pattern too. Okay? Now, down here at the bottom line, we have AC or actinium. See, if you can look that up and get, and see actinium, see, and this is, this line here is called the actinide series, because this is at the beginning of it. Actinium. I think that's how it's pronounced, actinium. Yeah, actinium. Do we have it? Okay, I just need the etymology. Let me see.
The atomic number?
You keep going down. Hold on, let me see, let's see. Go ahead and read the second paragraph. Yeah.
History?
Yes.
André, a French chemist, announced the discovery of a new element in 1899. He separated it from pitblende residues left by Marie and Pierre Curie.
Marie and Pierre Curie, very famous scientists.
After they had extracted radium. In 1899, Debonnet described this substance as similar to titanium, in 1900 as similar to thorium. Frederick Oscar Gieskill found in 1902 a substance similar to lanthium and called it
emanium. It's Latin for emanate. It means it emanates light. If you could find actinium, maybe if you can find the word in here that, let's see.
Named after the Greek word for ray.
I'm sorry?
Named after the Greek word for ray.
It's named after the Greek word for ray. In other words, like a ray of light. See, the ray of light. See, that's what it's pointing to. See, the ray of light. See, in other words, that would be like to the door, or like the cup of holy anointing oil at the door, the spirit.
Okay.
See, that's what it's talking about, the spirit, see. And that's what that's pointing to, see. Because we read that Moses and the Israelites were baptized in the cloud and in the sea. And that cloud, see, in that cloud, look, in the wilderness of Sinai, that cloud was a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. That's a ray of light, ain't it? Pillar of fire, see, that's like here, actinium. See, that's what that's correlated to, all right? So now we didn't got out of the court roundabout. See, we didn't went through the death, the burial, the resurrection, so to speak, or the blood, the water, the spirit. And now we're up here in this part right here. These are called transition metals here, all right? So now just quickly, let's look up here in the holy place of the tabernacle. What are the principles that we're looking for?
Light.
Bread, intercessor. So now let's just come over here and let's just look for the light, the bread, intercessor. Right here where it says W. See, W is the chemical symbol for tungsten. And if you know anything about tungsten, tungsten is a filament for light bulbs. All right? So now that's the principle of the lampstand right here in this section. We come over here. Look up here. Fe, ferrous. See, that's the chemical symbol for iron. Why? Because they tell you that, you know, you need, you know, if you got iron poor blood, you know, you need to go get you a bottle of Geritol or something. I remember where I come from, because we had, you know, winter and stuff. My mom, she believed in spring cleaning. All right, both the physical house and you, you know, and I'm telling you, I used to hate it because when winter broke and spring come in, we used to try to hide for her, and she would get us. And first we had to clean the house, which meant that we had to take all the furniture, every stick of furniture out, put it on the front lawn, and we had to scrub down all the walls and the floors, the windows, and then put it back in. And after we did that, then we all had to line up, and my mom had this great big ladle of a spoon, and we had to take Geritol and castor oil, you know, and we had to take dollops of it because she used to always feel like, you know, you kids are lazy, you know, you need to put some hemp in your step, you know, that kind of stuff, boy. And, oh my goodness, that's crazy. But because of iron poor blood, you know, ferrous, iron, see, all right? So that would be like the table of shewbread or like the manna in the wilderness, all right? And then we come over here, and we got zinc here. And the reason why I pulled this one out, see, that would be like the altar of incense, because, see, the altar of incense, straw line, corresponds to your lungs in the physical body. And when you have a chest cold or flu, you know, something that's dealing with, I know. Yeah, there we go, I think. Yeah, I think it's got a short in here.
Anyway, I usually take those zinc tablets for my lungs, you know, for my digestion, because it does wonders for that. All right. Now, am I still?
I am off. Huh. Okay, yeah, I'll do that. All right, now, yeah, so that would be like into the altar of incense, right, and we draw a line, see, which is like your lungs, and zinc is good for that, okay? Now, how am I doing on time? Okay, now we're coming over here, and I could turn this around like this, and it's this, see, because we're going up like this, the tabernacle pattern, and we're going into this green section up here now, and if you look here, and they got it profiled up here that the sixth element is carbon. And we are all carbon-based life forms, okay? Six. Six, that's that points to the sixth step of the tabernacle pattern, which is second departmental veil of blue, purple, and scarlet. All right? Now, that's correspondent to your physical body here, because at the neck region here, you have your thyroid gland. All right, your thyroid gland secretes iodine, and the word iodine means purple. Also in your neck region, you have veins and arteries. Your arteries is freshly oxygenated blood being pumped from your heart, right, which is medically depicted as red. And the veins are the deoxygenated blood that's being pumped back to the heart, which is medically depicted as blue. So at your neck region, you have the principle of the veils, blue, purple, and scarlet. Okay, now over here, we said that carbon is the sixth step. Next to carbon, we have nitrogen and oxygen. These two gases make up the bulk of the gases in the atmosphere. Okay, and so on a nice day like today here in California, you know, when you look up at the sky, what color is it? It's blue. All right, so that's one color of the veil here. Then we have this element here. We have iodine here, number 53, iodine. We told you iodine means purple, right? And then on top of iodine, we have this element called bromine. Bromine is reddish in color. So in this green area, you have the principles of blue, purple, and scarlet. See? And as we have carbon, which is the sixth element, that represents the sixth step of the tabernacle pattern of the veils, blue, purple, and scarlet. All right? Now here, this area here, this blue area, these are called noble gases. And the reason why they're called noble gases is because they are inert. That simply means this. They don't react with anything. You cannot take any of these elements and mix them with other. They don't react with them because they are liquids and all. We're not mixing with you. That's just how they are aloof. And see, and let's look at this. turn this around like this, see, like the pattern, this is the sixth step, this would be the seventh step. It would be like the most holy place. In the most holy place, you have the Ark of the Covenant. See, as was brought out, the Ark of the Covenant with the tables of stone, Aaron's rod that budded into almonds, and a pot of manna. And this is where the cloud sat on top of a mercy seat with the two archangels facing each other, but not looking at each other, witnessing to the glory of the flash of the Shekinah in the cloud. See, who is Elohim? Okay? Now, here.
These elements here. These are inert.
The noble. Helium, neon, argon, krypton, xenon, and radon. Okay? Now, they don't mix with anything. However, there is an exception. Neon will make an exception. Will mix with something. All right? Neon will mix with electricity. Electricity will cause neon gas to glow. Hence, we have the term neon lights. In other words, it will glow. Why? See, this is like unto the most holy place. Why? That would be like the flash of the Shekinah up here. Okay? So now we see here going according to the pattern. If you could look up the, I need you to look this up. The Octet rule. Do we have it?
Yeah.
The Octet rule. All right. Why don't you go ahead and read that paragraph?
The Octet rule refers to the tendency of atoms to prefer to have 8 electrons in the valence shell. When atoms have fewer than 8 electrons, they tend to react and form more stable compounds. When discussing the octet rule, we do not consider D or F electrons.
That's good enough. Because the basic thing is, and he's going to show it when he zooms in here. If you look here, with the exception of helium, if you look at the numbers here in the upper right-hand corner, see, and you see at the end of it, there's 8, the number 8. And you just go down to each one and see the number 8. See, that means there are 8 electrons in a shell. They don't have orbits. In the atoms, they call them shells. So in the outer shell of each of these elements, there's 8 electrons. See, same way here with all of them, except helium. Helium, because it only has 2. It only has 2. But all these others have 8 electrons in their outer shell, which makes them stable, which makes them integrated. In other words, they're stable. And so if you notice here, see when this column is at the end of a period. See each line here is a period, and when you count them up, there are 7 periods or 7 lines. Now, in other words, this line here goes all the way across to helium. This line here goes all the way across here. This line goes all the way across here. And this line goes all the way across here. And then you got these 2 lines, see, down here, which is part of this 2. So when you count them up, there are 7 periods. But at the end of each period, with the exception of helium, there are 8 electrons. Why? Because 8 is a principle. It's a principle of new beginning. See, when you come to the end of 8, you got to stop. Start over. Got to start a new period. See, stop. Start over. Got to start a new period. Because 8 symbolize a new beginning, okay? Now, that's just to show you briefly, the tabernacle pattern in operation. See, that Yahweh's got all the bases covered. See, and that, and this, I asked the guy about this. First time I met Sasha Rachmilovich. I met him in, it was 2002, and it was at the Albuquerque seminar, and I met him and found out he was from Russia and all that. And at that time, I was really getting into the periodic table, and I asked him about Mendeleev, because Dmitry Ivanovich Mendeleev was a Russian scientist. And I asked him about it, and he told me, he said, oh, the guy's a national hero over there. And they told me that they studied this, you know, from the time they were in grade school. You know, as I said, oh, well, no wonder these guys are so smart at chess and stuff like that. This is like, you know, this is normal. Whereas for me, I never took chemistry. Never. I never took a chemistry class in my whole life. I did take certain sciences that are related, like astronomy, and I think I took natural science in high school. But I never took a chemistry class ever, you know, because I knew, because this thing would scare me. I saw, because they had a big one. In the chemistry class, I and I said, well, I said, I know one class I ain't taking, because, you know, I know I'll.
That's how I feel. On the bottom is a little wire. I think it's the signal.
Uh-huh. Okay. Yeah, because I said, yeah, but now, you know, I understand it a lot better now because of the pattern. You know, I said, okay, you know, but when I was in high school, it was like, oh my God, I didn't want to get near it, okay? But this is the thing that Dr. Kelly laid out in his textbook, and see, about the 92nd Adam. And the reason why he laid it out, because what he was trying to dispel was the idea that mind had anything to do with anything. Matter of fact, maybe we should read that. Malachi, said 4:2. I change not. That's what I want.
Malachi 3:6.
3:6. Thank you. I knew it was somewhere around there. Go ahead.
For I am Yahweh, mm-hmm. I change not.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, ye sons of Jacob are not consumed.
All right, now, I am Yahweh, and I change not. Therefore, you sons of Jacob are not consumed. Now, mind, as we said earlier, is subject to change, right, either for better or for worse.
Right.
Okay? Now, the laws, what we call the laws of the universe, are simply reflective of the great law of the Spirit. Matter of fact, let me see. Where's that at? John 3:27. I think that's a scripture I want there.
A man can receive nothing.
That's it.
John 3:27. John answered and said, a man can receive nothing except it be given him from heaven.
They didn't come up with it on see, he's a respecter of persons to reveal whom he will reveal to. For example,
it's on my nerve.
Okay, this is an electrical formula. This is called Ohm's Law. This is the reason why the lights work. Right here. Okay. I had to learn this stuff when I was taking a class years ago, and I was trying to get a FCC general radio telephone license, which I did. And I had to learn all this stuff, you know. Let's see. Current. See, I think I got this one. No, let's see. Current. Yeah, current. Yeah, I want current. Let's see. Yeah. And so, anyway, this is the reason why the lights work, all right? If you didn't know what what the voltage was. Yeah, the voltage was. You can multiply these two. This times this will equal the voltage. If you didn't know what this was, then you could divide whatever the voltage is with this, and that'll give you this. All right? So this is the reason why the lights work. Now, if you break Ohm's law or you do not fulfill the parameters of Ohm's law, then the lights are not going to work. In other words, that's a type of a death. See? See, anytime you try to violate any of these natural laws, that's a death. Like, for example, if you were on top of a tall building, 30 stories tall, and you was up there playing around on the edge, and you slipped and fell, the law of gravity is not going to say, I know you didn't mean it, so I'm just going to suspend the law right now and not let you fall. No, you are going to fall, okay? Because that's the law, okay? That's the law. And any time you try to violate any of these natural laws, the penalty is death. Why? Because it's a reflection of the law of the spirit, see, which the penalty is death. Now, Dr. Kinley, how am I doing on time here? Okay. Dr. Kinley talked about man and their concepts. And see, and he talked about science of mind. And the reason why he even used that statement was because when he first moved to California, the year that he moved to California, this guy, he died, and he had written a book, which is called Science of Mind, all right? And this is sort of like, he was sort of like the godfather of what you would call the positive attitude type of thing, you know. People that used to write books like Norman Vincent Peale, I remember him, Norman Vincent Peale or Napoleon Hill, people like that, or that guy that used to have the Crystal Cathedral several years back, what was his name, Robert Schuller. Yeah, they were of this type of, you know, what they called mental, that you could mentally, you know, I mean, they were Christians, and they introduced this psychological aspect, you know, to Christianity, right? Well, if your mind can conceive it, you know, if your mind can think it, it can conceive it, and, you know, and make it a reality and that kind of thing, all right? And so Dr. Kinley was like saying, well, no, because mind is subject to change, see? And the reason why they even came up with that, because they tapped into ancient thought, you know, like Dr. Kinley called it, let's see. Help me out. Pantheism. Pantheism. All right. I took a class years ago, and basically what this guy told me was that in ancient pantheism, you have the ideal of rituals that could create a bond or a connection with your spirit and the spirits of everything else. All right? Some of these types of beliefs still are prevalent in certain Aboriginal peoples of the world, where they believe, well, you have the spirit of the bear, the spirit of the lion, the spirit of the tiger, spirit of the tree, spirit of the sky, spirit of the sun, the spirit of the moon, the spirit of man, even. All right? So all these things had a spirit. And so therefore, these folks reasoned anciently. They reasoned that through the process of rituals, see, they could create a ritual where their spirits could come together to influence the spirit of another. See, my most popular thing I always use is the rain dance. All right, these people are dancing, and they're doing a ritual, they're chanting. Maybe they might be doing some peyote or something to help expand their consciousness. But they're doing it in unison, you know, rituals, chanting, singing, you know, dancing, you know. Why? Because they're trying to influence, in this case, they want to influence the spirit of the rain cloud. And basically, they're just sending the rain cloud a message. Send rain, all right? And the spirit of the rain cloud might say, well, maybe, maybe not, I don't know, you know, that kind of thing. All right, but that's the whole idea behind it. Now, maybe once in a while, they may hit on it. You know, Yahweh might just send the rain over there. He was going to do it anyway, whether they did it or not. But, you know, but people, you know, believe that it works, and, you know, and it might have happened one time, so it reinforces the belief, well, we could just keep doing dancing, whatever, you know, then we, the man, we can influence the spirits of the other things to, you know, help us out. Okay? So that's the whole idea behind that. And see, and it's no more different than what they do today in church. You know, they say, you know, all right, after they do all the preaching and whatnot, and then at the end they say, okay, come on down if you want to be saved, let the healing begin, or whatever it might be, you know, and they come on down, you know, and they got, you know, these big mega churches now, they got like 10,000, 20,000 people up in the church that are praying for you. That's all right, we're going to pray for these people, you know, and the whole congregation is praying for this person or whatever to, you know, be healed or whatever. It's no different than this. You're trying to invoke the spirit of Elohim to say, well, look, Elohim, you need to do this. And Elohim is like, wait a minute, this is my will, not your will. My will be done, not your will. Okay? If I will for this person to be healed, I will heal that person. And I don't really need 10,000 people asking me to do this. All right, you see what I'm saying? And that's a bit of a sham anyway. And see, because I remember back in the days of Billy Graham, see, Billy Graham, he was like the evangelist preacher, you know. And this is how they divvy you up the spoils, you know. They you know, souls of men, this is, you know, that's how they divvy you up. Because, see, Billy Graham will come in and he'll preach whatever, and you know, maybe a whole bunch of people here, they'll come here, you know, to the convention center up here and here in Ontario and preach. You know, I got like 30,000 people up in there. And then Billy Graham, at the end of the service, he's going to leave. But see, and after those souls, they come down and say, well, come and give your life to God and all that. And they got people there. Well, Billy Graham is not going to hang around. He's going to the next, well, wherever. And then so they say, well, what do we do? I said, now the preachers who hired Billy Graham, they'll step forward and say, well, where do you live at? Well, I live in Montclair. Oh, well, brother so-and-so here, he's got a church in Montclair. You can go over there. Where do you stay at? Well, I stay in Pomona. Oh, well, brother so-and-so, he's got a church in Pomona. You can go here. That's how they divvy it up, see, because Billy Graham ain't there no more. But see, the other preachers are there. They say, okay, well, where do you live? Oh, well, you live over. You can go to him. And they just divvy it up, these souls, you know, that kind of thing, you know. Okay, I'm gonna give it a rest at this point, but I hope that you were edified by this, and that the stuff that I'm going through is the stuff that Dr. Kinley talked about, you know, and it's not anything strange or different or anything. It's just remembering the former things of old. That's how I look at it. Okay. I'm going to stop a little earlier because we're having some technical difficulties. And on our Archetype Pattern workshop page, we didn't live stream on that, did we?
No, we didn't.
So, and we just had some problems, you know, with that. But I recorded it in the camera, and so I'm going to take that home and I'm going to upload it on workshop page, and we hope that you've been enjoying the sessions from Jamaica. We got our student Nanette Ramirez. She's been there, and she's been uploading and live streaming. She's been doing a great job. I appreciate her for that. Okay. As we said, we hope that the things you heard were edifying. We hope that they were also enlightening, and we also ask that you take the time and research these things to see if they're so or not. We appreciate you studying with us, and we invite you to come back and study with us again. All right? And so in closing, where I simply say, be safe, be healthy, but most of all, be in Yahshua the Messiah. Why? Because he truly is your only hope of glory. And with those few words, hallelujah.
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 Okay, who's today? We have classes here. Oh boy, bad mic. Okay, Sundays 10 to 12. Tuesdays 7 o'clock to 9. Thursdays 7:30 to 9:30. Okay. Here at 1816 East Alma Court, Ontario, California. Also, you could donate the archetype pattern page. And anything else I'm missing? Nope. Okay, let's all stand, be dismissed. Now to him is able to keep you from falling, present you falling with his presence with exceeding joy. To only wise Elohim, our Savior, to Yahshua, the Star, Sovereign, be God, glory, majesty, dominion and power, both for all time, now and ever. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.